Well, good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome to the Lord's Houses. We celebrate the 506th anniversary of the Reformation. Just a few announcements. Did you see this out there? Did everybody see that? No, there's papers out in the narthex. Right down at the bottom, Jefferson Church to celebrate 100th anniversary. We made the paper.
Yay.
And it was that day, Wendy had a bunch of doctor's appointments, and I tried to rush back from Madison to get back from time for the pictures, and I'm in the middle. I made it. So there are some extra copies out there if you haven't seen it. And speaking of which, on the 100th anniversary, don't forget, I know it says in the Lion that there will not be a service next Saturday, but there will be. We will be having church at 5 o'clock on Saturday as normal. We may not go through everything like we will on Sunday, but we'll still have church for those of you who aren't planning to attend the anniversary. And if you are planning to attend the anniversary next Sunday, don't forget that the service is at 10 o'clock, not 9. And that afterwards, we have a nice meal being catered by Bon Ton. Of course, the menu is Swiss steak and Parmesan chicken. We need to know if you're coming or not. If you have not already signed up, please do so on the list of the narthex, or just call Erin in the church office and she'll get you on the list. The 100th year anniversary ornaments are also still available. Again, you can place $10 in an envelope with your name on it. The following week, you'll find your ornament on the back table or just up by the church office. Let's see. If you have any interest in the Grief Share program, Grief Share for the Holidays will be held Sunday, next Sunday, November 12th, beginning at 3 p.m. in the Little Angels Room. This is a two-hour program to help those grieving from losing a loved one and face the upcoming holidays without them. It's a video-driven program with discussion following to help you through the journey of grief. It's a 13-week Grief Share program, begins next Sunday and will go through January 7th at 2 p.m. here in the church. Does it say the 12th? Did I read that wrong? Or does it say the 12th? November 12th, which is next Sunday. What 12th am I missing? What?
We have our anniversary.
2 weeks! 2 weeks! Thank you. Yeah. In 2 weeks, November 12th. The Jefferson Food Pantry is looking for volunteers to work. If you can, please, if you can work 1, 2, or 3 hours, Monday through Friday, give them a call at the number listed in the bulletin. As you see, we still have quilts all over the sanctuary. They're still for sale. They're a $20 donation, and you can either place a check in an envelope and maybe get out to Janet Goggard, or you could place $20 in an envelope and place it in the offering plate. Apple pie filling has also been completed. There's 108 bags for sale, $9 each. Talk to Dick or Patty about that. And I believe that covers everything with the exception of Manna Monday. Don't forget that the Manna Monday that are indoors are October 30th, November 27th, and December 18th. December 18th belongs to St. Mark's, and volunteers are needed for that. And all the rest of the Mondays, with the exception of the ones on holidays, shall be takeout meals. And as always, don't forget about our Bible study. Tuesday morning, again, 8 a.m., we're at Four Sisters Restaurant in Jefferson. Thursday morning, 9 a.m. at a fellowship hall. This week, we finished up predestination last Thursday, and we begin a brand new Bible class this Thursday on angels and demons. Sunday morning, right after worship in the fellowship hall, we're looking at families of the Bible. That takes care of all the announcements that I have. I don't think I missed anything. Nick, do you have anything? Did I get it all? If I have it all in, it's time for anniversary reflections.
Well, the 100th anniversary is kind of special for my family. We've been involved in St. Mark's for 6 generations. My great-grandparents, Ernest and Martha Fisher, were charter members and were involved in creating this church, and the 6th generation was my grandson, who was baptized here by Pastor Zinn. Okay, I have the sacristy window, which is just outside that door. It was given in memory of W. Glider by Mrs. W. Glider and Donald. Before the addition of the educational wing, this area was the pastor's office. Though the office no longer is there, the windows still exist in their original locations. The noticeable one is on the west side of the hallway as one goes through the door leading to the educational window. The medallion contains an angel playing the violin. Angels are viewed as messengers and servants of God who came to earth to mediate between God and man. Window can also refer to God being present in the music that surrounds us in the church. There's another stained glass window which you probably have a hard time finding, because I couldn't have a hard time finding it. It's in the little angel's room behind the filing cabinet. It's very not noticeable. Anyway, it's another angel, medallion of an angel playing music, perhaps another reference to praise, harmony, and adoration found within the church. And that one was donated in memory of Mrs. L. Lutke by her daughter Mary. The other window is the window of St. Mark, which is in the narthex, which you probably see every time you come in. It's the winged lion, which is the symbol of St. Mark, the author of the Gospel of St. Mark, for whom our church was named. The lion symbolizes courage and power, and the rays emanating from him represented the majesty of Christ and the Holy Spirit working through St. Mark and his teachings. Mark traveled to Africa and became the first bishop of Alexandria, Egypt.
We follow our order of service as printed in the service folder. Please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I rejoiced with those who said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord.
One thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord, and to seek him in his temple.
Who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place?
He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to an idol or swear by what is false.
The Lord looks down from heaven on the sons of men to see if there are any who understand, any who seek God. All have turned aside. They have together become corrupt. There is no one who does good, not even one.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Blot out my transgressions, wash away all my iniquities, and cleanse me with my sins. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me.
Blessed is he whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord does not count against him.
I will exalt you, O Lord, for you lifted me out of the depths. O Lord, my God, I call for you for help, and you heal me.
God is our refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea.
The Lord Almighty is with us, and God of Jacob is our fortress.
Sing to the Lord, you saints of his. Praise his holy name, for his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime.
Sing to the Lord a new song. His praise in the assembly of his saints.
God invites us to come into his presence and worship him with humble and penitent hearts. Therefore, let us acknowledge our sinfulness and ask him to forgive us. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray. Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
He breaks the rule of oppressors. By Christ Jesus. God presented him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in his blood. He did this to demonstrate his justice, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate his justice at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Where, then, is boasting? It is excluded. On what principle? On that of observing the law? No, but on that of faith. For we maintain that a man is justified by faith apart from observing the law. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Gymnasts right there. Who watches the Summer Olympics and love to see those people bounce around all over the place. Well, I got a picture. Get this in your mind. A gymnast does a backflip high in the air and then lands squarely on a 4-inch balance beam. She executes the whole performance to perfection. The ending, it's flawless. She lands, it sticks the landing. The crowd goes wild. Remember those types of things? Who gets the credit? The answer is obvious. Shouldn't it be the gymnast? She's the one that puts in the long hours of hard work to gain those skills. She's the one who goes to the gym every day and practices and practices and practices to hone those skills to perfection. She's the one who performs in front of all those eyes looking at her. And, you know, the pressure can kind of get intense. So, all credit should go to the gymnast, right?
No?
What about the coach, I heard the coach. What about the coach? He's also the one who taught the gymnast her skills. He's also one who was there very early in the morning, as long as she was there, to make sure that she was doing everything right, that she was learning her routine. What about the coach? Does he get the credit? What about the parents? What about those parents who get up early in the morning to take their daughter to practice? Or it could be a boy. I don't want to be gender specific. What about the parents? Did they make sacrifices to be able to afford to give her the best coach money could buy so she could be a champion? Who gets the credit? I suppose it depends on your perspective. Depends on who you are. Well, today, as we remember the 506th anniversary of the Reformation, we're asking a similar question, but a more important question. Now, since the Reformation is all about the how and why we become right with God, or in biblical terms, how it is that we sinful human beings are justified in the eyes of God, we ask a question. Who gets the credit for our justification? You know, at the time that the Lutheran Reformation took place, the church was covered in the darkness of false teaching. I mean, the truth about Jesus had become so obscure that all kinds of false teachings had crept into what the church was teaching. And the most significant of all the false ideas was one that had to do with the most important question in all of Scripture. Namely, how does a sinful human being become right with God and get to heaven? So instead of relying on what God said in His Bible, instead of looking to God's Word, the church decided we'll just make up our own rules and our own ideas. The church decided that people could get right with God and get to heaven by being good. Can you see the halo above my head? Ting! Can you see that? People could get to heaven by being good. They still trusted that, or taught that you must trust in Jesus. But Jesus wasn't enough. To get to heaven, you had to respect the Pope as the ultimate authority here on earth, and the Roman Catholic Church as the one and only true church. You had to pray to the saints, and you did a lot of good things to make up for all the evil things that you did. You had to work your tail off, and then maybe, just maybe, you might make God happy. At least happy enough to allow you into heaven when you died. The people of that time took God and sin seriously. And they told, or and they did exactly what the church told them to do. Now that brings up a question for me. You know me and questions. Didn't the church have the Bible at that time? Didn't the church have that text from Romans that we was read just a few moments ago? That text from chapter 3? Just like we have it today? Well, of course it did. Even though God says no one will be declared righteous in His sight by observing the law, and even though verse 23 says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and even though God points out in Scripture that each and every single human being on this planet has missed His mark of perfection, and as a result, they are only deserving of God's wrath and a punishment because of their evil deeds, the church decides to change the rules. You know how that works, right? You don't like the rule, change it. It's that simple. It happens all the time when you think about it. The church decided that man could gain favor with God, could get God's approval by doing things that the church said were holy. They thought that man should get at least a little bit of the credit for getting right with God. The church thought that humans should get some of God's glory that belongs to God. And that was 506 years ago. And yet today, we have the exact opposite of the problem. Today, many people don't take sin seriously enough. They're not so concerned with what God has to say about sin and what sin deserves. Instead of taking what the Bible says about sin to heart, people today make up their own ideas about who God is and what His requirements are. I noticed, you know, it's not like I noticed for the first time, but I'm new here, right? It's been a few months now. And we all walk in the doors of the church each and every Sunday. Some of you more often than others because you're here doing other little projects during the week, whether it's Manna Monday or the Quilters or Bible study or whatever the case might be. But did you notice we have a little plaque out there in the narthex of the Ten Commandments? Have you noticed that? God gave us the Ten Commandments, and the people today want to take it as the Ten Suggestions. It's that simple. The Ten Suggestions. They say, surely God doesn't expect us to obey all these rules, right? I mean, don't be ridiculous. So they might even try playing the comparison game. Came to mind last night, or well, two nights ago, I'm not even sure what night, but you know what happened up at Maine with the mass murderer up there? People play the game of comparison with that. Surely, I may be a sinner, but I'm not a mass murderer like that guy up in Maine. Or maybe even they might try to play the balancing game. You ever do that? I'll just tip the scale in my favor. I know all the evil that I do, so I'll just do more good to balance it out. If I can get more good to tip the scale, then God will be okay with that. He'll be pleased with me. Did you ever do that? Or do you know that you are God's children? And as God's children, we take sin seriously and are well aware of what God tells us in the book of Ezekiel, where He says, the soul who sins is the one who will die. So if that's true, then why aren't people in church every Sunday? Why aren't the pews packed completely full right now? Why is it that I always have extra copies of my Bible study lessons after Bible class? Why aren't our Bibles? Could I challenge everybody to bring your Bible to church? Let's have a Bible inspection. In the military, those of you who serve, we always had the inspections. You had to show your stuff, right? So why don't we all have a Bible inspection? If you were to bring your Bible to church, would it be worn out from all the use it gets? Or would it be brand new where the seam is barely cracked? Think about it for just a moment. All those different things. And yet, we try to make sin as less than what it truly is. We don't always take sin so seriously. We try to solve or try to quiet our conscience by doing good or by being good. Instead of always looking to what God says in His Word and seeing how sinful we are really doing that. We're playing that comparison game. I know I'm a sinner. And I go to church on Sunday. But at least my church doesn't teach false teachings, right? Or even better than that, I know I'm sinful, but at least I'm not as bad as you. That's a fun game to play. We don't always compare our lives to what God's law has to say, but we are influenced by the people and the things of this world. We're influenced by our sinful nature. So this text, the text in Romans, speaks to our hearts directly. It's right there in God's Word. It's right there in verse 26 where God shows us how just He is, which means God must punish sin. And His text tells us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You catch that? What little one three-letter word in there kind of stands out to you? All. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Every last person, Who is born of this world in the natural way is born sinful and deserved to have God's wrath poured out on them. And we, sitting right here in God's house, we deserve to have God's wrath poured out on us. There is no room for us to compare ourselves to anyone else in this world or to make excuses for our sins, because we have God's law and it speaks to us and it says that every mouth must be silent and the whole world held accountable to God. The law puts a tight gag order on our mouths by silencing us with any excuse that we could ever come up with. No excuses. We know that we're not able to take any of the credit for our justification, because God says no one will be declared righteous in his sight by observing the law. Rather, through the law, we become conscious of sin. The law tells us that we're sinful through and through, and sinners deserve hell. And it becomes painfully obvious when you look at what God has to say, especially about justification, that we see the only credit that we can take is the credit for our sinfulness. But the Bible also shows us the answer to our question. Who gets the credit? Who gets the credit? Well, it's God. He's the only one who deserves the credit for our justification. Because if we truly examine ourselves under the microscope of the law, then we can clearly see that nothing we can do can make us right with God. Because if you believe that you can only, you can do so much good to wipe out all the bad things, the evil things that you've done, when will you know that you've ever done enough? If you can believe, or if you believe you can compare yourselves with other people, with the mass murderer, for instance, who are you going to compare yourself to? And really, it doesn't matter what we try to do. We always come back to God's Word. Because it's in God's Word He tells us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But praise God, He didn't leave us in the darkness of false teaching. Praise God, because of His undeserved love for us, that He said, "Now, a righteousness from God apart from law has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify." We are justified. We are made right with God. And since Wendy brought it up when I read my sermon to her this afternoon, she says, "Don't forget to add, like you teach it in Bible class, you know, when you look at the word justify, you got to break it up. If you take the word justify and break it into the letter, you say, just as if I never sinned." That's what justification means. That's what being justified is. It's just as if I never sinned. God took it upon Himself, and He tells us that He's the one who has made us righteous with Him. He's the one where He's given us this righteousness that comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. In spite of our sinfulness, in spite of our failure to make things right with God, He made things right with us. No matter what sin we have committed, no matter how many times we have sinned, no matter how much our conscience may accuse us, we have the robe of righteousness wrapped around us because of Jesus and what He has done. You and I have been made right with God because of what He did. There is no difference, for all who sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Him as a sacrifice of atonement through faith in His blood. He did this to demonstrate His justice, because in His forbearance He had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate His justice at the present time, so as to be just and the one justifies those who have faith in Jesus. It's as simple as this. And I know some of you who attend my Bible studies have heard me do this before, but for those of you who haven't, I'm going to do it for you now. What would you do if you were standing at the gates of heaven right now? You're standing there and God Himself is looking at you and He says, "Why should I allow you into my heaven?" What would you say to Him? Would you say, "Well, Lord, you should let me in because, hey, look, I go to church, I give to charity, I do good works, I go to Sunday school, I've taught Sunday school, I've done all this, I give my help to whoever it needs it. I've lived my life better than most people." Or would you say to God, "There's nothing about me, nothing about me at all worthy enough that you would allow me into your heaven?" But I hold on to your promises. I hope that you have mercy on me, a sinner who's held on to your promise that your one and only Son has done everything that is required. So picture yourself at the gates of heaven. You're standing before God who punishes sin. He's a just God. He must carry out his justice. But when God looks at you, when he looks at your sinful life, when he looks at how you have failed to give him the perfection he desires, that he demands, you realize, of course, he only sees Jesus and what he has done for you. When he looks at you, he sees Jesus living the perfect life for you. He looks at you and he sees Jesus being nailed to the cross for your sins, for your guilt. He knows Jesus suffered the pains of hell in your place. He heard Jesus say, "It is finished." And he sees Jesus rise from the dead. He knows that Jesus has done everything for you. So it's time to hear the answer from God. Especially after you give him your reason why he should let you into his heaven. You know what you're going to hear? "Come, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world." All because of faith in Jesus. Not because we've done anything, not because of who we are, not because of our background or what church we belong to or our family, not because we have enough money. We are allowed into heaven simply because God created faith in our hearts that trust that Jesus has done everything that God required. So when we ask the question, who deserves the credit for our justification? Well, then Scripture makes the answer very clear. God has provided everything. Everything necessary for us to get to heaven. He gave us his one and only Son. We are sinners who deserve absolutely nothing but God's wrath and punishment, and yet thanks be to God that he made things right with him by sending Jesus to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Thanks be to God that through faith in Jesus and all that he's done, we are God's children and heirs of eternal life. There is no question who deserves the credit for our justification. The credit, who gets it? The credit belongs to God. Brothers and sisters in Christ, this is God's word for you this evening. Please rise. "And now may the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen." Let us now join together in confessing our Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs in this prayer for the Reformation. Almighty and eternal God, when the time had fully come, you sent your Son to take our place under the demands of the law and to endure the just punishment for our sins. For our sake, you accepted his sacrifice on the cross and raised him from death to glorious splendor.
Praise the Lord, O my soul, and grant all his benefits.
When the time had fully come, you bestowed your Spirit on your people as a testimony that you had called them to proclaim the gospel to every creature. Equipped and encouraged, they carried the word of salvation into all the world.
The Lord reigns. Let the earth be glad. Let the distant shores rejoice.
When the time had fully come, you raised up your servant Martin Luther to restore the pure and right teaching of Scripture to a troubled church. You renewed your people with the light of your love, and your holy church grew and prospered throughout the world.
God is our refuge and our strength, and ever present help.
When the time had fully come, you made our forefathers bold to take their stand on the truth of your word. You have blessed their sons and daughters and enabled us to preserve and proclaim the saving gospel.
Sing to the Lord, for he has done glorious things. Let this be known to all the world.
Let this be a time, O Lord, when you renew us again by word and sacrament, when you reform our hearts and minds, and when you restore to us the joy of fellowship and service. Grant to us in this age and in this place the courage of the apostles, the steadfastness of the reformers, and the dedication of those who have gone before us.
May the Lord our God be with us as he was with our fathers. May he never leave us nor forsake us.
May this be a time, O Lord, for confession and repentance. Forgive us for the apathy that harms our faith and hinders our works. Forgive us for boasting of our past achievements and for blaming others for our present problems. Rid us of indifference to public worship and Bible study. Destroy the distrust that plagues us and shatter every thought and word that harms the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace.
Create in us pure hearts, O God, and renew steadfast spirits within us.
Let this be a time, O Lord, when we recommit and reconsecrate ourselves to the ministry of the gospel. Let us find joy in our unity, zeal for our work, and success in our labor.
May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face shine on us, that his ways may be known on earth, his salvation among all nations.
And we join together in our Father's prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Brothers and sisters, share in the Lord's peace.
Thank you.
generosity toward us, we obediently share this offering in full knowledge that all of our resources and assets are ultimately a gift from you. Help us to use them wisely and to share them generously. We ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord, our God.
It is good and right so to do.
Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In love, he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. By his saints and witnesses of the past, he encourages us to run with perseverance the race marked out for us and to live in righteousness and peace. Now have come the salvation, the power, and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and thanks and honor and glory forever and ever.
Holy, holy, holy Lord. Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." He then took the cup and gave it to, and after he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." O Christ, the Lamb of God, that takes away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us and grant us your peace.
Amen.
Please be seated. Please rise.
He ran.
Trunk or treat. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.